even before when he was singing with a quartet and when he was thin. And I was thin too. They used to call me Skinny Lenny. They don't call me that anymore. Amen. We're going to get in the Word here in just a few moments. Let me just say very quickly, though, it is an honor to be here. And, you know, I appreciate the longer I'm around and the more I have seen, you know, a whole lot of stuff traveling. I appreciate the integrity and the heart of this man and woman of God here and their desire to see God's people blessed. And not just blessed, but to live right. And that can be a rare commodity to have a desire to see God's people live right. Amen. I'm just going to start somewhere. I had the Lord begin to say some things to me. Actually, I could show you the date on my notepad is on the airplane. I started to hear a few words in my spirit, and it has been developing ever since there. But in the last couple of days, I've had the Lord just drop a few words in my heart like promise. I've had him drop the word inheritance. I had him drop in my spirit the word receive versus achieve. And I started thinking about some of this stuff. And, you know, I began to really hear the Lord saying to me, sometimes I think we've been in such a posture to achieve things. We've really not realized that the new covenant is really about receiving and inheritance. It's about being sons. It's about being, and because you're sons, there's an inheritance. And how many know if you have an inheritance, you didn't work for it? Come on, somebody, help me just a little bit. I'm going to read from my device, but I usually hold this up when I used to do it from a Bible because I'm getting even better with using a device. My grandbaby said, "Pap, you don't have to do this. You can do like that. It'll work like this." And I'm like, I can't figure that out. But I always would hold my Bible up and say, "I have with me a copy of my father's will." Now, how many of you have a Bible in your hands? You have a copy of your father's will and testament. How many know a testament is a will? And I like to think of it like this. My father wrote a will one day. And he wrote this Old Testament, if you will. And then he had a son. And the son was such an incredible businessman that the father got richer. And he had so much fun with this first son. He said, "I think what I'm going to do is bring many sons into glory." And because he got richer and had some more sons, how many know he had to write a new will? Come on, somebody, help me just a little bit. So he wrote a New Testament. Touch your neighbor, say, "Somebody died and left you something." And you know what is a tragedy to me is that we've never read our copy of the will to realize there's a whole lot of inheritance clauses in this thing that are just incredible to me. And you know, we have most of the church world, because they've never read their copy of the will, they're settling out of court. Y'all awful quiet up here in New England. You know what? I have an attorney on retainer because we do. By the way, we do. If you're interested, we do a national television program that airs on three different networks nationally. As a matter of fact, we'll be on in the morning at 7:30 a.m. on Impact Network. We're on Mondays on Impact Network, on Dish Network, and DirecTV, and then we are on Wednesdays on GEB America, on DirecTV, and a lot of cable markets. And on Thursday, we're on. I think it's 12 or 12:30. I'd have to look to see what time exactly we come on, but we're on Uplift on those days. But I have an attorney on retainer, and my attorney said to me, he said, "I want to show you a court case." And when he showed me this court case, at the end of this case that he would present, he would say, "These things we pray the court." That prayer is an actual legal term. I don't know if we have any lawyers in here or not, but it is an actual legal term in the courtrooms of the American courthouses. Did you know that? That when you present a petition, and then at the end of it, they will say, "These things we pray the court." And I started even looking at prayer totally different, because what happens is the moment you pray, is that your attorney, hallelujah, picks up what you have requested. Now, how many know you have an attorney on retainer tonight, whose name is Jesus Christ, the righteous, whoever lives to litigate? I feel the Holy Ghost a little bit. He ever lives to make intercession on your behalf. And the moment you pray, if you have a legal right to whatever you're praying for, the courtroom of the heavens receives a docket, and if it is in favor, you receive a judgment from the court that says it's in your favor. Hallelujah. Then your attorney picks it up and says, it's legal. They have a legal right to it. Come on, somebody. But how many of you don't know who you are and you don't know what you have, you will settle out of court every time and you will miss a whole lot of stuff that belongs to you. And I'm afraid the American church especially has given up a whole lot of stuff. One of the inheritance clauses in, you know, Matthew chapter 5, it said the meek will inherit the earth. That's in my copy of my Father's will, Pastor. That's in my copy of the will. I don't know what you want to do with that, but I'm going to take it to court. I said, I'm going to take it to court. I mean, I believe if there's anything God wants to do right now in the American church especially is to wake us up to realize, listen, we're going to have to begin to be the salt and the light in the earth that's going to turn some stuff around. We can sit and complain about it till the cows come home. But until we realize our role in the earth is to bring about change, because we have a legal right to do that, we're going to continue to settle out of court and get beat up. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. I was with one of the programs I was on, there was a guy on before me who's a theologian, and he read the scripture, Matthew 5, the meek will inherit the earth. And he said, this was his comment. This guy was a theologian. He said, I don't know what that means. He said, I think that means that the wimps, you know, or the, I don't know if that's a good term here. I find when you preach in other countries, you know, words that mean something here don't mean it there. Wimps or, you know, weakened, bashful, whatever, you know. He said, I think that means the wimps are going to inherit the earth. I said, well, then what about blessed then are these wimps, if that's the case? Because it's talking about blessed there, because it's really dealing with what, you know, the Beatitudes are basically attitudes you need to be in. There are attitudes that teach you how to receive the kingdom, and then attitudes that teach you how to release and minister the kingdom. And he said, I don't know what that means, the meek will inherit the earth. And so he went on, you know, thinking, well, I think it means that the wimps are going to get it. And, you know, and he was like, I said, what about blessed are these wimps then? So when I usually don't try to rebut right after somebody else is on, but I came on, I said, I'd just like to have a shot at that. I don't know if I'm a theologian or not, but here's what I think that scripture means. Are you ready for this? I think that scripture means the meek will inherit the earth. No confusion. See, it didn't fit with his theology, so he's trying to figure out it's got to mean something. No, it's in my copy of Dad's will. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. The earth and all they that dwell there. It's in my copy of Dad's will. Come on, somebody. But what I love is the writer of the book of Hebrews says this. It said, but without the death of the testator, the will is not effective. So he came and wrapped himself in human flesh and died so you could get what's in the will so that the will could become effective. Somebody died and left you something. I feel a little preacher coming on me. Somebody died. Listen, but what I love is there's been a lot of people died and left you something. I've been to a few will readings in my time, been in the ministry as long as I have. And, you know, there's a lot of people who have maybe left the will even somewhat vague where they would argue and fight and sue each other over something in the will. But here's something that's never happened in human history, but it happened in the person and work of Jesus, is not only did he die so you could get it, but he got back up from the dead to be the administrator of his own will. To make sure you get what he said you could have. Hallelujah. And I want to talk about, you know, even I have heard these words in my spirit to where, you know, even when I give an altar call, I've shifted somewhat what I say when I do that in inviting people to come to an altar instead of saying, come to Jesus and give him your life, and that's okay. But I, you know, when I gave him my life, I don't know where you were at, but I didn't have much of a life to give him. I had a lot of death, a lot of wreckage, a lot of train wreck. Come on. So now these days when I give an altar call, I say, come to Jesus and receive his life. Because how many know it's more about what you receive than what you give up? Come on, somebody. When you receive his life, what we don't realize is that under the old covenant, they couldn't receive his life. They could receive rules, but they didn't receive his life. And so I want to talk about inheritance a little bit. I don't know how far I'll get. There's some fresh things stirring in my spirit. And if you help me develop them, we'll see where all it goes. But I want to turn to Galatians 3. This was just in my spirit on the way up here, and we'll see where all it takes us this evening. But I want to start in Galatians 3. I've been looking at the book of Galatians in the last a couple of days, but I want to begin just reading in verse 1. We'll go down through chapter 3. I don't know how far we'll get. We may pick this up again if I don't finish the remarks I want to make about that in another service or so. It says, O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth crucified among you? This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? And all of a sudden, I begin to hear him talk about receiving the Spirit. There's a lot of stuff we receive. He said, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Have you suffered so many things in vain? If it yet be in vain, he therefore that ministers to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. Let me just stop and develop this, because this is stuff that's working in my spirit, and I may not be as polished with this tonight as I am sometimes. You don't know me, but I want to develop this because the Lord's really kind of dealing with me in my heart with this. He said, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Paul is really dealing with an issue here where if you read the prior chapter, he said, if I build again the things that I once destroyed, I become a transgressor. When I started looking at that scripture, what Paul was talking about is not going back to rock and roll or drugs or whatever we think was his life before that. What he's saying is, if I go back and I start to restore back the old covenant of the Mosaic system and I go back to putting that stuff back together again, then I become a transgressor. And he's rebuking Peter, who has come down to these Galatians. And while he's with the Galatian brethren, he's eating with these Gentiles, which is not really something that was real acceptable in the early first century church, because they just beginning to realize God's going to do something among the Gentiles. And so Peter came down there and he would eat with these Gentiles until the boys that he wanted to impress from up at Jerusalem showed up, and then he would get up and act like he wasn't a part of that. And Paul said, I had to withstand him to his face, because even Timothy got caught up in their hypocrisy and their dissimulation. And so he's talking about, if I build again, in other words, if I go back to the stuff that I'm telling you we've come out of, just to make somebody else happy. Help me, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. If I go back up under that just to make somebody else happy because they're in my peer group that I want to impress, when James and John and those guys came down, Peter got up and acted like he wasn't part of this thing. Paul said, listen, man, what you're doing is you're getting all of these guys caught up in your dissimulation. He said, I'm not going to build again what I've been preaching that we've come out of. Now let me just take my time tonight and develop this. He told you I came up in classical Pentecost under what I call terrorist preachers. Now let me make that clear, because I'm not talking about strapping a bomb to yourself and blowing something up. I'm talking about guys that would scare you every time you walk through the door. I mean, it would be, they preaching against everything you could imagine. I mean, we was always here's the general rule. If it's fun, it's going to take you to hell. I could always see myself making the nasty plunge in the lake of fire, because I could see, I mean, everything you could think of was a sin. Let me just demonstrate, because I've done this all over the world. But these guys would come in. We'd get ready to have revival. And these preachers would come in. I'm excited about revival because I'm just a young born-again Christian who just got saved. I'm excited about Jesus. But the longer you got in religion, the more the joy starts to leak out of you. But so I was glad revival was coming, and these guys would come, and man, I was always impressed. If I could just be around the preacher and he just acknowledged me, say hello or something, boy, I just really think this is awesome. And these guys would come in, and they looked like they fell off the cover of, Botany 500. They was dressed in suits and three-piece suits, and their wife looked like Granny from the Beverly Hillbillies. She had her hair in a top knot and a beehive, I tell people, my mama has a PhD. You say, what's that? That's a Pentecostal hairdo. When the Holy Ghost would hit, she'd get a jerk order, and then bobby pins be flying off of them, smacking the walls, be hit by flying objects. I was telling Dale about being down in Orlando and Willie Hinn's church one time, and man, people started falling out in the spirit. This guy fell on me, man. I got pinned under this huge dude. I got a spike high heel right in the top of my foot. Hallelujah. I've had a few preaching injuries in my time. But man, we'd preach against, and so this guy'd come in, man, and he looked like he must have picked a fight with his wife on the way to church just to get his game face on, because he was the evangelist, you know, but he looked like he was mean, you know. And he'd get up and he pulled his glasses down on his nose, and usually they had suspenders, they pulled their pants about midway up their chest and lean back, you know, and say, "You want me to name sin?" And you got to hack when you do that, you know. "I'm going to name it for you tonight. Some of you women came in here with makeup on your Jezebel face. You got head levelers on your head. You got makeup on your face. You got a television set in your living room. You eating deviled ham, deviled eggs, devil food cake. And you wonder why God, you got to stretch God out, ain't moving in the church. It's because there's sin in the camp." And we preached against everything from devil food cake to, I mean, fashion. And we preached, I mean, we preached stuff wasn't even in the Bible, man. I've told these stories because they kind of get people loosened up a little bit. But I'll never forget when I said to my pastor, he got to preaching against Coca-Cola. And that was back way back in the end of the 60s, first part of the 70s. And I said to my pastor, "What about a Coca-Cola is going to take me to hell?" I'm thinking, you know, I'm already impressed that this God must really be serious about fashion, because he's going to send people to hell for an outfit. Now, I'm thinking you might get busted by the fashion police, but we really thought people were. If you had on a pantsuit, we didn't need a text to preach it from. We're going to preach, "Women, don't dress in men's apparel." But we never read the next verse that said, if you mingle your thread in a garment with divers kinds of thread, it's in the same chapter. So if you had on polyester and rayon, you was as guilty as the lady with a pantsuit. But I never heard anybody ever preach against wool and linen. But it's right there, you know. Or I never heard them preach against a pork chop. But it's right there in the same chapter in the book of Deuteronomy, I call it. Hallelujah. So I said to my pastor, "What about a Coca-Cola? It's going to take me to hell." He said, "Son," he couldn't even talk to him in his regular voice, had to talk in the preacher voice, "Son, you drink that Coca-Cola from a bottle, it's going to ruin your testimony. Somebody going to think you're drinking something else." And I'm thinking to myself, then why aren't we preaching against root beer? Because that's a brown bottle. I mean, why the Coke, you know? And then he looked at me, he said, "Son," he said, "that Coca-Cola is shaped like a woman, and it's liable to make you lust." And I'm like 16 years old, and I said, "Thanks for that image." So I struggled with Coke till I got in my 40s. And then they came out with 3-liter bottles, and I got over it. Help me, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. But everything was a sin. Devil's food cake, deviled ham, everything was a sin, man. And so, you know, what we did was we started to disqualify everything. But, you know, the truth of it is what we did was we picked and chose what out of an old covenant paradigm, what we wanted to, what fit our culture. And we called that the gospel. I'm not going to get real far tonight because I'm going to lay some groundwork. And you probably know a lot of these things. But back some time ago, the Lord spoke to me from the book of Timothy, back in the early days of first seeing the message of grace and the new covenant. Was he said to me, "Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." And so I thought that meant, Pastor Dale, that if I went to school and got enough education, that maybe I'd study enough, God would be happy with me, that he could use me. And I'm certainly not against education. I do believe in it. I have a little bit of it. And, you know, that's not what he's saying. He was saying when you study to show yourself approved. And, man, I heard that ring in my spirit. Don't get in the Word to find out what's wrong with you. Find out how you got approved. Find out how you got in this condition. Find out who you are in this new creation. Come on. And under the old covenant, you were a servant and a slave. In the new covenant, you're a son. And if you're a son, you're an heir. And see, I'm going to talk about inheritance and promise and receiving, because I believe that God wants to posture us to receive. And we're only going to receive when we realize we don't have to earn it anymore. Now, I'm not saying there's nothing to be done. I'm just saying that once you get salvation, you're not working to get it, but you will work out of salvation. And you will flow from a realm of understanding who you are. And once you study to find out that not only am I approved, I'm approved on the basis of something that was done in the person and work of Jesus Christ, is that I've got my Father's approval and I am accepted in the Beloved. And that Paul wrote to Philemon, and he said that the communication of your faith is by the acknowledging of every good thing that is in them. So what I started seeing is, look, I'm start looking for what's wrong with you. Man, that's the way I learned to preach, is get in the Word to find out what's wrong with them. We would brag about after services, boy, two of the hide off of them tonight, didn't it? Boy, didn't I step on their toes tonight? That's like a bunch of guys, you know, with white beater t-shirts hanging out. I said, boy, I sure beat the Bride of Christ up tonight, didn't I? That's just dumb now. I look at that thing, that's dumb. I'm not looking for something. I don't go home and say, I'm looking for something wrong with my wife to pick, nitpick at something, you know, of some flaw she's got. Are you hearing what I'm talking about? I begin to study to show myself approved unto God. And a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly divided the word of truth. And I begin to understand that rightly dividing the word of truth does not just mean you can handle Greek and Hebrew. And I believe in that too. But rightly dividing the word of truth is being able to discern what is truth in relationship to the old covenant. And what is truth in relationship to the new covenant? Because the new covenant is not an addendum to the old one. I'm going to say that again. I said the new covenant is not an addendum to the old one. The fact that there's an old one and there's a new one tells me one of them had to fade away. One of them was based, come on performance. And the other was based on grace through faith. And the old covenant was written to servants and slaves, while the new covenant is written to sons. And see, if you don't get this identity piece in the midst of it, you hear the message of grace or the finished work, and you're going to get lawless. I feel too much in my spirit here tonight. And see, what I want you to see is he's really, one of the things that the Apostle Paul is talking here about in Galatians is, he said, number one, did you receive the Spirit? How many know that the Spirit is part of the promise? He told them, go to the upper room and wait for the promise. Because the promise was not just a piece of real estate someplace. The promise was the Spirit. Hallelujah. And under the old covenant, they had rules on rocks. In the new covenant, we've got the Holy Ghost. Under the old covenant, I like to show people this. When God began to deliver the children of Israel out of Egypt... Man, I'm a mess here tonight. I'm just exploding in my spirit. Let me get this scripture. Somebody grab your Bible or get me this. Revelation, the 11th chapter, verse 8. I'll quote it if nobody's got it. But I came across this scripture, and this thing has really boomed in my spirit for the last several months. But it says this in Revelation 11. It says, and their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city. Is that right, Dale? Which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. Is that pretty close? Now, I preached, you know, I just finished 130 messages on the book of Revelation that's back there. By the way, I did it on a national TV program. It's a wonder. I figured it'd be the death of my ministry, because that's totally not the view of most people. But our response went actually up, because I think people are looking for some good news in the midst of where everybody else has cried, the sky has fallen. Hallelujah. But when I was teaching Revelation 11, he said, their dead bodies will lie in the street of the city, which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. And it dawned on me while I was reading it, for as many times as I've read that, it dawned on me, our Lord was not crucified in Sodom or Egypt. Boy, y'all quiet. Our Lord was crucified in Jerusalem, just outside the city of Jerusalem. But here's what the Holy Spirit does to that. It calls the city where our Lord was crucified, the city which is spiritually called Sodom in Egypt. And for the first time, I started to see Egypt not as what I had, you know, my preconceived concepts of Egypt is, when we thought about preaching, we came out of Egypt, we thought that meant we came out of the world. I mean, we came out of whatever your bondage was, we came out of it, you know, that was Egypt. But see, what he's connecting the dot to here is Jerusalem was the centerpiece of Judaism. It was the centerpiece of where the temple was at. It was the centerpiece of where the law was given, or where the law was kept. Are you hearing where I'm coming from? And it was where our Lord was crucified. So for the first time in my life, I started seeing the bondage of Egypt as not being the bondage of the world, as we would say out here, you know, what we would call sin, but it was the bondage of religion. So what he's saying to them is, our Lord was crucified. Hallelujah. See, it's easier, I think, to get people set free from drugs and alcohol than it is to get them set free from religion. Now, please stay with me when I say that, because that just sends reverberation things. I'm not talking about not living right, because I want to say to you very clearly, I am a preacher of grace. But and I believe that what God desires from us is for us to live right. What is in question for me is how that occurs. Because law can make you behave, but grace will change your heart. Law can change what you do, but grace will change why you do it. Are you hearing where I'm coming from? So when I started seeing that they were coming up out of Egypt into this promised land, that they left Egypt delivered by the blood of a spotless lamb. They put blood on the doorpost of the house. Hallelujah. And not just blood on the doorpost of the house. There's more to this lamb than just his blood. They also took the lamb inside the house. And they ate the whole lamb in the night, roast with fire. See, there's so many messages I could preach here. Hallelujah. Because how many know what happens is the best time to eat more lamb is in your night season. They ate lamb, and it was the middle. Listen, they ate the lamb in the middle of the night, because what happens is, as I believe, as we have shifted in our ministry towards majoring on the person and work of Jesus Christ and his finished work, we are serving lamb on a regular basis. Come on, touch your neighbor, say, eat more lamb. Tell somebody else, nothing but mutton. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit said to me a number of years ago, you ate your way into this problem, you can eat your way out of it. I said, if you can eat your way out of it, I was born for this. Because I have an anointing for that. And the Lord said to me, it started with an eating disorder in Eden's misty garden when I said, don't eat that. They ate that, and it caused this problem. 400 years after they're in the bondage of Egypt, God said, now I want you to eat this. And what they ate started to get assimilated into them. There was blood on the doorpost, and the lamb was inside their house. And the more they fed on lamb, the more they fed on Jesus, the more they fed on the finished work, the more they, come on, put lamb inside the house. About midnight, at the darkest hour, something rose up in them and said, I cannot live in this bondage any longer. Something in me says I was born for something greater than slavery. It was born for something, come on, the servitude. I'm convinced, I don't care what your bondage is, whether it's religious bondage, worldly bondage, substance abuse bondage, you get enough lamb in your house and somewhere something will get in your spirit that says, I can't live like this anymore. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So they got up and they left Egypt delivered by the blood of a spotless lamb. They got blood on the doorpost and a lamb inside the house, and they leave Egypt. Now, they're not in the promised land yet, but they've left Egypt. I believe that's where a lot of people in the American churches, they're not in bondage to religion anymore. Let me work this patch. But they're not in the promised land yet of rest. And so they come up out of Egypt, they come into the wilderness, they're happy to camp there. And the Egyptians start to pursue them on one side, and the Red Sea is on the other. They've been delivered by blood, now they're about to be delivered by water. And so they come to the bank of the Red Sea, and the same water that seems like it's opposing them, God is going to open the waters of the Red Sea, and they're going to cross over, and the same water that saves them is going to destroy their perpetual enemy. I still believe in water baptism. Hallelujah. I believe it's a picture of the beginning of another covenant, because I believe that the token of the covenant, under the old covenant, it was circumcision. In the new covenant, a circumcision of the heart, I believe through water baptism. And I still believe in baptism, because what we're going to see here is in Galatians, he talks about you were baptized into Christ, you put on Christ, and something happened. It's more than you just got wet. It was a sign that you've entered another covenant. You've left something behind you. Come on, somebody. I've left Egypt behind. I've left slave mentality behind. I'm not a servant. I'm not a slave. God, through this whole wilderness journey, is trying to get them to lose their slaves mentality and shift into a sonship mentality, to quit looking for somebody to tell me what time to get up, what I should eat, what I shouldn't eat. It's time to get somebody that can be governed by the Spirit and learn how to live out of the Spirit. Come on, somebody. And live in a place where the inheritance could come, where they're not just slaves, but they're inheritors, they're owners. And so they leave Egypt. They cross over the Red Sea, and the same water that saved them is the same water that destroyed their perpetual enemy. And the waters of baptism, see, and I believe this person. Somebody said to me, can you go back once you've been saved, water baptized, born again? And I tell people, I won't tell you you can't go back. I'm just going to tell you it took a miracle to get you out, and God ain't going to give you a miracle to let you go back. If you're going back, you're going to swim. It's harder to go back than you think it is. The way of the transgressor's heart. How many of you besides me have went back? You know, I tell you what, especially when I first started preaching the message of grace, there was a lot of people that went back, started to go back to test the waters of freedom, to go back to stuff they came out of. Now stay with me for a moment. Because, see, one of the first stops the children of Israel made when they came out of Egypt, now they're no longer slaves. They're no longer in bondage. They're no longer in Egypt. But their first stop, this is not an accident. One of their first stops was in the wilderness of sin. It is not an accident that it's called the wilderness of sin. And, man, when I first started preaching grace, I started to get real concerned. And I said, God, maybe I need to go back and preach a little bit of law. Now, how many know that Paul calls that a perversion of the gospel? But I started seeing stuff happen, and I thought, you know, in all honesty and sincerity of the heart, I want to see people not ruin their lives. And see, the guys that are kind of coming against the grace message, I think the sincerity of their heart is they feel the same way, and I identify with that. I agree. I don't want to see people wreck their lives either. But what's in question is how this change is going to occur, see? And so we came out of Egypt, and man, I started seeing people get free from whatever. Let's call it, because tonight we're talking about religious bondage. They got out, and for the first time, they are free. Nobody is there to tell them what to do. There's not a taskmaster. So I'm free. I'm free. I'm going to show you how free I am. And so they started to show you how free they were. I call it Facebook free. I got almost 8,000 friends on Facebook, and I want to write to some of them and say, just because you can don't mean you should. And if you do, don't put it on Facebook. Because what they really did was they traded this bondage of religion for the bondage of substance abuse or the bondage of alcoholism or, help me, Holy Ghost, in the case where there's a guy that travels with me who came from an Italian mob background. Bobby Kennedy tried his dad. But this guy came from the street. He didn't know nothing about God. He gets saved, comes off the street. I mean, he didn't even know. The first time I preached on Moses, he said, you mean that's in the Bible? I said, yeah. He said, I saw that movie. Charlton Heston started in that. Is that where they got that's in the Bible? I said, that's where they got it. So I bought him a Bible, man. I mean, he didn't know a thing about God. And then he says to me, after he's with me about a year, he said, I got it, boss. I said, you figured it out in a year. He said, I got it, man. I read this book. And he said, I figured. I said, what do you think it's about? He said, it's about gang wars. I said, I don't remember that in the Bible. He said, yeah, that's right there behind the book of Malachi. I said, you mean the book of Malachi? He said, yeah. He said, yeah, there was this gang of Jews named the Pharisees. And there was these Italians named the Sadducees. I said, you mean the Pharisees and the Sadducees? He said, yeah, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. I said, man, I got to get you a Bible here that you can understand. Well, he come off the street, man, delivered 300 a day in cocaine. He ran bars and guns and I mean, it was organized crime. His dad was a boss. And so he comes in off the street, and the first thing we try to do with someone like that is we make them come over here and get into the bondage of religion. Are you hearing? You hear what I'm saying? And so he's over here, you know, getting Christianized. And the folks that have been in Christianity is swinging by him headed to the other side. And they're getting in bondage to what he just got set free from. And I start thinking, wait a minute. We're like a bunch of monkeys swinging back and forth in the wrong tree. We're swinging back and forth in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And all we're doing is trading our bondages. So you're still not free. I don't care what your bondage is. See, in Galatians 5, it was for freedom that Christ set us free. No longer to be entangled in the yoke of slavery. And he's talking there about religious bondage. But nevertheless, it's for freedom. And so what happens is a lot of people think they're free, aren't free yet. All they've done is actually change bondages. Well, hallelujah. And so we find this, it's a completely, see, there's another tree. It's called the tree of life. It's another tree. We've got to climb down out of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil and get a hold of a life. What he wants to give us in the new covenant is not a law you have to keep. It's a life that will keep you. Jesus said, I came to give you a life. See, if there was a commandment that could have given life, then verily righteousness would have been by the law. But the law couldn't give you a life. But in the new covenant, we receive the Spirit. Hallelujah. As an inheritance. And as a promise, and as a free gift. And Paul said, you started out in the Spirit. You left Egypt. You got delivered by blood. Nobody had to tell you, stop that. Don't do that. But you, come on, you started seeing stuff drop off. Not because you had to, but because the Spirit was doing the work in you. And if the Spirit started the work in you, he said, what are you doing going back to resort? To touch, not taste, not handle, not. If the Spirit could get you started, the Spirit will finish the job. And so I begin to realize, help me, Holy Ghost, that when they came out of Egypt again, they stop in the wilderness of sin. It is exactly, I'm going to deal with a whole bunch of things there that I haven't dealt with just yet, but I want to get this picture first. Exactly 50 days after they leave Egypt, they're at the foot of Mount Sinai. God comes down on Mount Sinai and gives the people the law. And the people with one voice said, we will do it. And if we do it, it will be our righteousness. Wrong answer. The rocks aren't even cold until they've already broken them. And as a matter of fact, when God brought them out of Egypt, man, there's too much here to preach. He didn't bring them out based on the Mosaic covenant. He brought them out based on the promise God gave to Abraham. They came out under the Abrahamic covenant, which was a one-sided covenant. It wasn't like, if you do this, I'll do that. God said, listen, this is my promise. Hallelujah. In blessing, I'm going to bless you. And there's a seed that's going to come out of your loins that's going to bless the nations of the earth. That in you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. And I came a long way to tell you tonight that you're a blessing looking for a place to happen, because you're the seed of Abraham. We'll get there before I get done. We're heirs according to the promise. And since we are, hallelujah, we're a blessing, and we are commanded to bless the nations of the earth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The nations of the earth are waiting on sons to begin to operate like real sons. Not like slaves waiting to escape something, but like sons who've received an inheritance. And because they've received an inheritance, they know they've got a substance they can draw from that can reach out, come on, and touch the nations of the earth with the substance of the life of God that's in us. Because what we've got is more than a piece of real estate. When God spoke to Abraham, he said, Abraham, I am your exceeding great reward. In other words, Abraham, you got me. And if you got me, you got everything I own. Hallelujah. Touch somebody. Say, we got him tonight. We've got him tonight. Not only do we have him, but he lives and moves inside of us. And everything he is in the midst of this people tonight. And of his fullness have all we received. And grace piled up on top of grace. Moses gave you the law, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Moses gave you rules. God was offering a relationship. They came out of Egypt based on the Abrahamic covenant. And it was a covenant that says, I want to bless you, and I'm going to bless your seed. And they came out of there because God remembered his promise. And God told him, I want to make a whole nation of priests out of you. I want every one of you to have a personal relationship. I'm going to make a nation and a kingdom of priests. But the moment God came down on Mount Sinai, the people said, we're afraid of him, Moses. You go talk to him. And they substituted a personal relationship for a mediator. I ought to probably read Galatians 3 because it's got all this in it. They substituted it for a mediator when they could have had a face-to-face relationship. And so the moment they forfeited a face-to-face relationship with God for a mediator, and now they don't have a relationship, now they've got to have rules. And so God gives them the law. And when God gives them the law, the people call on themselves and they read out the curses of the law. And they would read the curse. Cursed shall you be if you move your neighbor's border. And the people would say, amen. Cursed will you be in the city if you do this. And the people would say, amen. Cursed will you be if you do this. And the people would say, amen. And if you read that in Deuteronomy 28, I believe it is 27, 28, there's about all kinds of curses. And the people said, amen, after every curse. And then you go to the next chapter and he starts reading the blessings. And not one time in all of that did the people ever say amen. They never said amen to the blessing. They said amen to the curse. It reminds me, growing up under those preachers, that the more they preached against, the more we'd holler amen. We was calling a curse on ourselves the whole time. We're just saying, anyway, I'm a dog, I'm a dirt bag, I'm a dog, you know, Sal returned it to its wallet. I'm a generation of viper. I mean, we're hollering amen. We didn't think we'd been to church unless we got a beating. Come on, somebody. We didn't think we'd been to church unless we had the hide tore off of us. And we left there feeling like a bunch of dogs beat down. And no, hallelujah. But I came, when I was again teaching the book of Revelation, Jesus, he says this at one of the churches, he says, I'm the amen, and I am the beginning of the creation of God. In other words, what Jesus was saying is, I'm going to be the final amen to the curse, because I'm going to be a curse for you. And because I became the final amen of the curse, come on somebody, now I'm the beginning of a brand new creation, so that the book of Revelation ends by saying, grace and peace be multiplied, or it says, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and it ends with an amen. Because in Christ, all of God's promises are yes, and what God's looking for is somebody to say yes and amen to the promise. Because Jesus said he was the final amen. In other words, everything you had coming under the curse, he became a curse for us. He took everything you had coming under the old covenant so you could get everything he has coming under the new covenant. He became, come on, your sin so you could become his righteousness. Hallelujah. He became, if you will, sin and disease so that you could receive the righteousness and the blessing and the provision. Rejected, you were received. He was beaten and bruised because you had a beating coming, but he was wounded for your transgression. He was bruised because you had a bruising coming. The chastisement for your peace was laid on him. You get peace, he took the whipping. I know there's a lot of people trying to preach against that today, but I still believe Jesus, became sin. I still believe he was wounded for my transgression. I believe it pleased the Lord to bruise him, by whose stripes we are healed. Hallelujah. In other words, he took everything you had coming so you could get what he has coming. So when they came out into the wilderness of sin, God gives them the law at Mount Sinai. And when he gives them the law, the people forfeit a personal relationship for a mediator system and a two-sided covenant that says, if you do this, I'll do that. If you do this, I'll do that. See, under Abraham's covenant, that was not how it was. God walked through the pieces, and he walked back through it, saying, here, I'm going to swear by myself in blessing. I'm going to bless you. Hallelujah. It was I think they call that a grant covenant, because it was a one side. In other words, you had nothing in it. It was based on God and his promise because of election. And Abraham believed God, and God counted it to him for righteousness. And so all the promises of Abraham brought them up to this exodus from Egypt. The moment God gave them the law on Mount Sinai, 3,000 people dropped dead. Now fast forward into the New Testament, 50 days after Jesus, who is the true Lamb of God, is slain. They're in an upper room. And the promise. Hallelujah. The promise, he told them, go to the upper room until the promise of the Spirit. Because the promise of the Spirit was an indwelling. God was bringing them back to his divine intention clear back before they substituted this, what Galatians 3 calls an addendum.
an addendum to the law, or an addendum to keep a sinful people away until the seed should come to whom the promise was made. That seed was Christ. And it was a promise, not a performance. It was a promise. And so when God gave the Spirit in the new covenant in Acts chapter 2, exactly 3,000 people. This is not an accident. Exactly 3,000 people are added to the church. You say, why is that? Because under the old covenant, 3,000 dropped dead. The letter kills. In the new covenant, the Spirit gives life. And if you don't hear nothing else I tell you all weekend, this is probably the most important thing I'm saying right now. You might want to write it down. I don't know. It may not seem important to you. So that the Holy Spirit is to the new covenant what the law was to the old covenant. So if under the old covenant, God gave them rules on rocks, in the new covenant, He gives you the Holy Spirit. One was external, the other is internal. Now, if the Holy Spirit can't make you behave, all the rules on rocks ain't going to help you. If legislating righteousness was the way to do it, we've got plenty of laws. But the end of the law was there's none righteous, not even one, because it is a bankrupt system that was not, hallelujah, able to make you perfect or to give you any kind of life. All it could do is expose how far and how great you really are missing it. And the point of the law is to bring you to the end of yourself so that at some point you'll say, I need a Savior because I can't do this on my own, because the law was designed to bring you to Christ. See, you can come out of Egypt, and a lot of people came out of bondage. A lot of people got set free from law and legalism, but they didn't come to the second step of this thing where they start to receive the Holy Spirit, because if you come out and you get free with an out and indwelling Holy Spirit, it's hard to tell what'll happen. But if the Holy Spirit can't make you behave, all the preaching we do ain't gonna help you. Here's what happened. When they came out and they came into the wilderness of Shur, I believe it was, and the Bible said that They begin to drink the waters, and the waters got bitter. I just was researching this week about the waters, and the reason the water got bitter, and this was so interesting to me, was because it had within it, let me see if I got this in my notes, it had inside this water, this was so cool to me. Let me see if I can find it in my notes. Yeah, I still got to do like this because I haven't learned the part like that yet. The waters, when they came out, the waters of Marah were high in magnesium and calcium, and it caused diarrhea. And the reason it caused diarrhea, this was so cool to me. You say, well, that sounds really gross. Well, the reason it caused diarrhea is it was to clean out all of the Egyptian diet. It was to clean out, because and God knew exactly what He was doing. He knew exactly what He was doing. He's going to clean this whole mess. He's going to clean out all. Hallelujah. I think sometimes, man, we have come to a place where we think the water's bitter and God knows what's good for us. It's going to get all the mess and the stink out of us. All of the traces and appetites of Egypt and all of the diet of Egypt, it was to change their appetites and to shift their diet from an Egyptian diet and to get rid of all the pollutions of the bondage of Egypt. And the second thing that was used for it, that the calcium and the magnesium together, was also if you drink that in water, it kept you from cramping your muscles so that you could be good for the long journey and you could be there for the long haul. And so God knew... They're in the wilderness, and they need something that's going to keep their legs from cramping. One of the things I do when I'm in foreign countries, especially when there's not air conditioning, is I drink a lot of tonic water. If you have problems with cramping, my daughter-in-law is a medical doctor. Or if you fly on airplanes for long periods of time, you might get cramps in your legs. So I drink tonic water. Tonic water has quinine in it, and it will take a cramp out just like that. So here's God who already knows the first thing we're going to have to do is get them out of Egypt. And now we're going to have to get to Egypt out of them. So I'm going to take them, I'm going to take them out here, give them all diarrhea. I hope this don't sound unreligious, to get the crap out of them. Because there's a lot of religious crap in the game here. Can I side path just a minute? You know, God even gave them commandment, Pastor Dale, because he knew I'm going to have to tell them what to do, even to how to use the bathroom. I have a whole message on this. I believe it's in Exodus. It says this, and it shall come to pass. I like that. That's a nice King James word. And it shall come to pass that when thou shalt ease thyself abroad. Now, that's a nice, beautiful way, King James saying, when you got to go, you got to go. He said to Moses, and thou shalt issue a paddle upon thy weapon. Now, that was a Hebrew word, paddle upon thy weapon, was a nail or a spike or a something to dig with, if you will. It was a piece of standard equipment that they carried on their belt that looked like it could have been a tent peg. It's translated some places as a nail, a tent peg, or a shovel type thing. And God said to them, I want you to issue every one of them a paddle upon their weapon. Everybody gets a porta potty. I know y'all wonder where I'm going with this. You may not come back tomorrow night. I don't know. Hallelujah. But he said, thou shalt issue a paddle upon thy weapon, and it shall come to pass that when thou shalt ease thyself abroad, go outside the camp, dig a hole, and cover that which cometh of thee. That's poetic, isn't it? Cover that which cometh of thee. I think that's pretty good wisdom, because God knew these people wouldn't have enough sense. There's a lot of stuff could be preached here about this. Here's one thing. If you feel like you're going to stir up a stink, go outside the camp. Don't take nobody with you. I've always wondered about women when they go to the bathroom. They got to have five of them. It's like, what do y'all do? I mean, if I looked over Dale and said, I got to go to the bathroom, let's go to the bathroom. And I got him by the hand, you all think, this is not good. But women will take five of them. I don't know what you're talking about in there. I don't know. I don't want anybody around. But how many know when people sometime in a local church feel like they go stir up a stink, they take everybody they can with them and get them involved in their stink. Come on, somebody. But he said, go outside the camp, dig a hole, and cover that which cometh of thee. But what I really started to see was, to cut through a whole lot of fat, Jesus, let me stop first of all by the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah said one of the first places he came to when he came to survey the city was he came to the dung port, Outhouse Row, and by the dragon well. So there's two things here you need to understand. First of all, the dragon well was mythically where the head of a dragon was cut off. So the first thing in restoring the church is you got to realize the devil's been defeated. And the second thing you got to do is figure out how you get the crap out. Is that okay to use the word here? That's not, I don't know any other, dung, I don't know. The Greek word for scabola. I learned that from Kelly Varner, hallelujah. Touch your neighbor, say scabola happens. Sounds like a bumper sticker, don't it? Hallelujah. And so he stops by, and the first thing he has to see is that there's a dung gate that's here in the city. Now, when I took that ancient map and looked at it, Jesus, according to Hebrews, was crucified outside the city. And when I looked at this map of Nehemiah, Jesus was crucified outside of the dung gate. Now, you're probably wondering where I'm headed with this, but it's something powerful when you get a hold of this. He was crucified outside of the dung gate. But see, the Apostle Paul gets a hold of this, and he said, listen, I am a Pharisee of the Pharisees. As touching the law, I was blameless. I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel. As touching the law, I was blameless, but I count it all as scabola. Come on, somebody, that I might win Christ. So what he was saying is you got to take take all your human performance. You got to take it outside the city and realize Jesus took all your mess. Jesus took all your struggle. He took all your stink. He took it outside the city and with that nail. The same Hebrew word for paddle upon thy weapon is the same word that's translated into Greek as the nail that nailed Jesus to the cross, because he took that nail, got rid of all of your religious dung, all of your worldly dung. He got rid of all of your Egyptian mess. He took it outside the city. He dug a hole and he buried that which cometh of thee. He said so that when the Lord your God comes down to walk among you, he doesn't see any uncleanness. God wants to walk in our midst because when he comes, he wants us to see that Jesus has so dealt with your mess that God can walk among us and there's no uncleanness in the camp. No religious uncleanness, no worldly uncleanness, because Jesus, through the power of the cross, has dealt with your mess. Oh, hallelujah. Sometimes that's why we come to bitter waters, is to get rid of all of the diet of Egypt, to get rid of all of the uncleanness, to give you something to drink that may not taste like you're familiar with, but it's going to keep you from cramping and season in the long run. And you'll start to run with patience the race that was set before us. I know I'm not doing this justice, but I got to jump over here in Hebrews and say this. The Lord spoke to me a couple of days ago out of Hebrews 12, and he said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us, and run with patience the race that's set before us. Because see, when you unload all of the stuff that's holding you back and you get rid of the cramping, you're able to run with patience. You can run, Forrest, run. Come on, somebody. Because you're not feeling the cramp. Because God took you to some water that you didn't maybe like the taste of. I've got to find a place to circle and land here. But when I was preaching that, and we may pick this up again in another service, for the first time in my life, I began to see that the sin of Hebrews 12 was wanting to go back to Judaism. The context there is these men of faith, by faith, reached forward to a promise that was in the future, and they, by faith, did something in the visible realm that was a picture of the personal work of Jesus Christ. And the whole theme of the book of Hebrews is so that your heart can be established in grace, that he tells them, if you have been enlightened and you tasted the power of the coming age and you go back to Judaism, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. He's not talking about if you went back and did some bad sin, like I said, a bad word. And I'm not justifying that. Are you hearing where I'm coming? Am I making sense to y'all? What he's saying is, don't go back to Judaism. That's the sin. Don't miss the mark. Don't do it on purpose. He says, because if you sin willfully, right in the middle of the whole text in Hebrews chapter 10, where he says, listen, man, we have been perfected forever on the basis of the sacrifice of Jesus. We've been sanctified forever. It's not volatile. You got it. It's once for all. He did it. Listen, if you're a believer, he said he has perfected forever them who are sanctified, and that you were sanctified by the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And right after that, he goes, then he starts into chapter 10. He says, but if you sin willfully, once you've been enlightened, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. And I'm like, well, this don't seem like it fits the context here. And all of a sudden, I begin to realize he ain't talking about if you did something bad since you've been saved. I know I've been a while, but let me take my time here. How many of you sinned since you've been saved besides me? Every head bowed, every eye closed. How many of you did it because you wanted to? Plotted it, planned it, carried it out, and enjoyed it. Nobody want to raise their hand there, but I did. Hallelujah. See, if that's what that scripture means, we're all lost. I would say let's close in prayer, but that ain't going to help us. We might as well just leave tonight. And the first time I ever heard that preached, if you sin willfully, once you've been enlightened, and I just got saved at the age of 16, and I'm thinking, I wish you'd have gave me that piece of information before I got saved at the age of 16. Because my chances of making it in now have just got real slim. Because I have sinned since I have been saved. And I did it willfully. So did you. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about the coming age and the power of the coming age. The coming age was the new covenant age. The old covenant age was fading. And he's saying, if you've tasted this, and you've tasted the heavenly gift, and you've been enlightened, and you've seen the power of this coming age and this new covenant, and you go back to circumcision, and you go back to animal sacrifice, and you go back to Judaism. Listen, there is a movement in America right now to go back to, I'm just going to be bold because it really needs to be corrected. They're wanting to wear prayer shawls and everything else. And the reality of it is, God didn't call you to go back to Judaism. Hello. As a matter of fact, that's what Paul's warning these Galatians. Who bewitched you? You started out in the Spirit. Don't go back. That's the whole point. Don't go back to this old covenant. And so when he says to them, if you sin willfully, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. He's not saying you can't be saved if you do something wrong. He's saying if you go back to Judaism and you offer the blood of a bull or a goat on an altar, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. In other words, there's not another sacrifice coming. So if you think the blood of a bull or goat is going to help you, you are sadly mistaken. And we've got half the American church right now that's waiting on a restored temple in the Middle East. And they don't realize they are the temple of the Holy Ghost. And it's a whole lot better than the one over there. If he was interested in that one, he'd have kept it. Come on, somebody. And they half the American church would go back and offer the blood of a red heifer on an altar somewhere. I'm telling you, that's absurd to me. There is no other name given under heaven whereby men must be saved. That's what Paul's talking about. If you go back willfully and you go back to Judaism, there's not another sacrifice coming. Are you hearing me? In other words, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. It's not another one coming if this one didn't do it. That was the sin of Hebrews. Going back, the weight was carrying the performance base of an old covenant paradigm. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us. Let's look away from this and let's look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Are you hearing what I'm coming? In other words, look away from this. Stop carrying the burden. Stop carrying the load. Stop missing the mark. And look unto Jesus, because that's where the new covenant flows from. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me just say a few more remarks, and I'm going to circle the land here. I preached way too long. The Holy Spirit is to the new covenant what the law was to the old covenant. So exactly 50 days. See, they that are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. The contrast is we're not led by rules and regulations, but we are governed by the Holy Spirit. Being led by the Spirit is not weird. It's not spooky. It's not out in never land like, no. It's knowing this voice inside. Hallelujah. That when ain't nobody watching you, you ain't around the church sheriff. The enforcer of the rules is nowhere to be found. The Holy Spirit is inside of you. And he's the yes or he's the no. My pastor says this all the time when our young people especially, they'll come and say, is it all right if I do this? She says, if you can get it past the Holy Spirit, it's all right with me. But how many know there's a lot of stuff we try to get past the Holy Spirit that the Holy Spirit is not for? And he's sitting there because he won't leave you or forsake you. He said, are you done yet? Have you messed up your life bad enough? And you even go back to the wilderness. Like I said, you come out of Egypt and you test the waters of freedom. And at the wilderness of sin, you test the waters. Any besides me ever go back and try to do some things you got delivered from? And what'd you find out? It wasn't near as fun as it used to be. You sat there and thought, my God, these people here act like they're having fun, but I'm miserable. You know why? You know why? It's not your nature to sin anymore. It's a violation of your identity. And when you feel that violation, that's the no of the Holy Spirit. It's not an audible voice, but it's the yes or the yes of God who says, there's a lot of stuff we preached, especially again growing up in classical Pentecost, that's no more sin than not. I mean, it wasn't even the Bible, devil's food cake. Where'd you find a text for that? You know, I mean, some of the stuff we preached, I mean, even with dress codes. They wore robes back then. Somehow we got it over to maxi dresses. I remember when they preached against regular dresses and women started wearing maxi dresses. And then when the maxi dresses came in style, they preached against them because now you're worldly for being in style. It's like God is really serious about fashion and diet, evidently. Man, this guy don't like devil food cake, evidently. But what I'm simply saying is, man, there are some things that, you know, that I used to think was wrong that I feel the yes of the Holy Spirit in. What Paul says in some of this, he said, you know what? If you offer yourself to sin, it's your last free act. In other words, if you become a servant to something, in other words, all you've done is trade bondages. That's not freedom. But when the Holy Spirit comes into our lives, He does more than just make us talk in tongues. Go ahead and stand on your feet. I'm nowhere near going to get done Galatians 3 tonight, but we'll pick up and continue to develop this. Hallelujah. You know, I've seen this work in my family with my kids. And sometimes say, you know what, I'm not going to, especially when they get old enough to make some decisions for themselves. You take them off to college and drop them off the first day of college, and what's in their heart's going to show up. I've seen a lot of people recently, they're taking their kids to college and they're sad, and I got so identified with that feeling the moment they left, and it's like the empty nest syndrome is there. But I tell all these sad parents, they come back and they bring other people. And then they bring more people. Hallelujah. But when you commend them to the work of His Spirit, see, I would say to my boys, listen, I'm not going to make you do this. And especially my oldest one, he was always real tender towards the Lord, man. He'd act like he was going to be in rebellion, but just a little bit he'd come back and say, I feel like the Lord's dealing me to do this. So, are you understanding where I'm coming from? How many know what I'm talking about? I believe we've never really taught people how to live out of their spirit. And I think one of the reasons that I'm finding that preachers won't preach the gospel of grace and the new covenant is because they don't really think the Holy Spirit can do what He says He can do. Now, you may have to stop at the wilderness of sin until you get all the crap out of you. And the water gets bitter. But here's the wonderful thing about even that location. When the water became bitter, the Lord showed Moses a tree. He said, just put a tree in it. I got to tell you, that takes me clear over to the cross. And says, what you need to do is come back now that the water is bitter and preach the cross. In what way? Watch this. To preach the cross, just to bring people back and say, you were crucified with Christ. It's not an ongoing thing. There's an ongoing revelation of what all that means, but you were crucified with Christ. You're dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And the more you preach the cross, that you were crucified. See, Jesus did not die so you don't have to. He died because you had to. He did not die to give you a life. He died to give you a death. He got back up from the dead to give you a life, but He died to give you a death to who you were in Adam. And the moment you put that tree, you remind people, you're dead. See, that's what Paul did in Romans 6. Should we sin so grace can abound? God forbid. How can we who are dead to sin live any longer? He put the tree in it. He kept showing them, this is not who you are. You're living out of a wrong identity. Even when Paul dealt with sin at the Corinthians, what? No, you're not. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. That text is to correct people. He said, are you going to take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? Because I'm not going to leave you. So if you're going down to the house of idols and you're going to join yourself to a harlot, are you going to take the members of Christ because you're a member of Christ? Are you? See, that to me is a powerful deterrent. That He ain't leaving me. He's right there going, are you done yet? Don't you know who you are? Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, so that you're not your own. In other words, He continues, are you hearing where I'm coming from? He continues to bring them back, not from a negative viewpoint, but from an understanding of who they are and who lives inside of them. The Holy Ghost is more than a shundai and a hukumashat. I love all that about it, but man, the Holy Spirit is my constant companion. And I used to think I was talking to myself, but I think now I'm talking to the Holy Ghost all the time. And now I'm hearing Him talk back. Come on, somebody. How many know what I'm talking about? My son said the other day in a youth camp to the young people, he said, "How do you know what God sounds like?" And my son said, "He sounds a whole lot like me. He sounds like my voice talking to me." That's so powerful, because we've made it so mystical and hard, so that only a few glow-in-the-dark preachers can be led by the Spirit. No, man. Paul's commending these people to the power of the work of the Spirit. And he said, man, you listen, you started out in the Spirit. You received the Spirit as an inheritance, as a promise. Do you want to go back to the performance stuff that you came out of? If I build again what I destroyed, what? If what started in you doesn't finish it? And then he comes back and says, listen, man, you're not servants anymore. You're sons. And if you're sons, you're heirs. Hallelujah. There's a whole lot of stuff that we inherited. And we might look into some of the inheritance clauses before I go. But I just wanted to kind of get this first part. Hallelujah, because I really feel the Spirit right now having me emphasize everywhere I go the workers of the Spirit in the life of the believer. Because a lot of people are preaching what we're free from and what we've turned from, but not very many people are preaching what we've turned towards. And while we are no longer governed by rules on rocks of an old covenant paradigm, we are governed in the kingdom. There's another form of government called the kingdom. It's not in our future, it's in our now. We are citizens right now of the kingdom of God, because one of our inheritance is the kingdom of God. And the end of this book of Galatians, he starts telling them, "You, they that do such things are not inheriting the kingdom, because the kingdom comes by inheritance." And once you inherit the kingdom becomes another form of government. And that form of government is not rules on rocks. It's an indwelling Holy Spirit, because the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. It's righteousness, peace, and joy. It's located in the Holy Ghost. I love the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands all over this room. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I will not leave you comfortless. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Hallelujah. I will send you the Comforter. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we just embrace our inheritance tonight. We receive. Come on, just say, I receive, Lord. That it's not about achieving, it's about receiving. We receive the Holy Spirit. We receive our healing. We receive, hallelujah, the gifts of the Spirit. We receive. Everything is about receiving. We just posture ourselves tonight, God, to receive. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm just, you know, hearing the Spirit of the Lord say that he that started the work is the same one who finishes it. Hallelujah. You know, I'm reminded, you know, in West Virginia back a few months ago, there was a massive flood that hit southern West Virginia, and it was just one house after the other that was painted red, and it had like a sign on it that says, this house is condemned, it's uninhabitable. And when I thought about Romans, the 8th chapter, where it says, there is therefore now no condemnation. I thought about it in terms of that flood, which means if it's condemned, it means it's uninhabitable. But there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ. In other words, you are inhabitable. And because you are inhabitable, he starts a major renovation program. And he comes in, he starts the work, but he also finishes what he starts. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And I just hear the Lord saying, man, just receive that which the Lord shall do on your behalf. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I feel like even physical healing, the Lord said, just receive in your body some healing tonight. Receive in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You really, when the children of Israel again left Egypt and they came to that wilderness of sin, once they put a tree in the water, the Bible said they left that bitter water, and their next stop, I believe, was Rephidim. It was very closely after that, and Rephidim means rest. And rest is simply the place that you've come where you trust him. If you're not resting, it's because you don't really trust yet. Under the law, it operated by fear, but perfect love cast out fear. If perfect love cast out fear, perfect fear cast out love. So if you sit under fear, you can't be made perfect in love. In other words, what you fear, you ultimately come to hate. And that's why people are struggling with this ability to really embrace God and let him embrace them, is because they just really have a fear. But I'm telling you, there's a place of rest that we're moving into that's a confidence in knowing God is going to do what he said he could do. Hallelujah. I probably just need to quit, because I'll be talking about the transgression, and the transgression was simply unbelief. They stopped believing the promise of the Abrahamic covenant, and God gave them another one because they were looking for something outside of that covenant. And the law was added because of that transgression, because the moment they came to the wilderness and they started to murmur, I'm hungry and I need something to drink, they didn't remember that the promise of God to Abraham and Isaac and to Jacob was, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you clothes to drink. I'm going to give you clothes to wear, food to eat, water to drink. I'm going to be your exceeding great reward. And the moment it looks like God isn't doing what they want him to do, because he's giving them what he knows is best for them, water that'll clean them out and get rid of the cramps, they stopped trusting him. And the transgression was they stopped believing, because the law shuts up faith, and the law is not of faith. Hallelujah. The transgression began, and God gave the commandment that was an addendum for 430 years until the seed should come. Until the seed should come. And the seed has already come. And his name is Christ. Hallelujah. It's not seeds as of many. It's not, come on, two seeds. It's not. It's one seed. And if you be Christ's, then are you Abraham's seed. If you're Abraham's seed, you're in Dad's will. Hallelujah. I trust this has blessed you tonight. I feel like I've obeyed the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me just say very quickly, we have brought with us some, just a limited amount of our books and things back there. Beauty and the Beast I wrote in 1993. I think you probably in this house would probably be real receptive of what's in that book, because Beauty and the Beast is basically this: Adam and Christ. There's two men of the earth. The first man is of the earth, and the last man was the Lord from heaven. As we've borne the image of the earthly, we'll bear the image of the heavenly. Beauty and the Beast. The second book I wrote is called The Revelation of Jesus Christ, and it's really, I went to the book of Revelation, decided that this book is titled The Revelation of Jesus Christ. We preach everything from this book but him. So why not preach Jesus from a book that's titled The Revelation of Jesus Christ? That book is back there. And then my last book is titled Unforced Rhythms of Grace. It's from Matthew 11, where he said, are you tired? Are you weary? Are you burned out on religion? Come to me and I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me, work with me, see how I do it. I'll teach you the unforced rhythm of grace. The unforced rhythm of grace is learning how to walk in the Spirit.
That book is back there. There's also a stack of CDs back there that are in envelope. They're free samples of our Message of the Month Club. If you want to be part of our Message of the Month, it's $7 a month or $7 or $70 a year or $77 a month. $7 a month or $70 a year. Take those. They're free. If you like it and you want to sign up, it's there. Then there's jump drives back there that have a whole bunch of stuff on them, and I'll explain all that to you. I hate to talk about stuff. God bless you. I feel like I've obeyed the Lord tonight. I hope this made sense to you. I feel like I've been all over the place, but we'll start connecting dots the more we go. God bless you. Pastor Dale, come on. Hallelujah.